Hello and welcome to another episode of eBay Scavengers. This is episode number 43. And here we are with all of us in one room. No, we're not in one room. One Google Hangout. One chat. So we are talking all together about what's going on in our stores this week.
So we had a pretty slow week for ourselves, and there's really not too much interesting. I mean, we had one big item sell, and the guy didn't pay. And we've already been writing him the nicest letter possible, trying to get him to pay for these $200 boots we took a best offer on.
I sent him a letter. I would really love to get you these great boots that you got at a great price. And I can have them to you by the week's end. We're shipping tomorrow. All I need is for you to pay, but nothing.
Not even a response.
Yeah, I think that's – we've had that happen to us too over the past year. And that's why we're starting to take off best offer on items that we know will sell and we know the price of it.
Like those boots that you guys sold are easily worth that much. So just put them on fixed price. I mean, that's been my thing lately on items where I'm like, I know it's worth that much. Best offer, take off best offer, you know?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. On this particular boots, we have like 8 pairs of these Lucchese boots, and they're all a little different in style. And I was having a hard time pricing them because each year they change all their styles out. So I was having a hard time figuring out what the retail value was for each one. And there was a huge range from like $150 to $1,000, depending on the boots. So oh, wow. We certainly had them at a fair price. But I think our real issue on this one was we've had so many no pays in the last few weeks, and it's all for the stuff like $100 or more that we have to really fight to get paid now. And it is part of a best offer issue because we can't collect immediately on that.
And we should add that we just made a store-wide change to our store. We wanted things to move. We wanted to kickstart a dry period this summer. So we just did an across-the-board store-wide switch to best offer.
Yeah, that's a good way to kickstart things. My mom did that too because she wasn't doing best offer, and she put best offer on almost everything. And she's like, I can't believe how much stuff I'm selling. So it's good. But for some lower price things, like we're saying like $30 shoes, I'm like, that's how much they're worth. That's it.
Yeah, it's nice that the bulk lister, when you go to convert things, like if you go into a store of thousands of items, the bulk lister allows you to say, like, items over $30. Like, there was some logic there, so I could avoid putting best offer on my low-priced items.
I think, too, that we've always known that once we put best offer on things, about 10 or 15% of items will not get paid for. It's just how it is. People are flaky.
I don't know if you guys have experienced this, but did you reach a point where you'd been running your store for a year or more, and then you look back and realize that a lot of your inventory might suck, and that some of your descriptions were really based on different reasoning than, you know, didn't reflect what you learned. So you have to either go back and delete stuff or change the way you phrase things.
Or make things super cheap, like $12, like just get it out the door. I did that with some of our really old stuff, like stuff we'd sold, you know, still had up like literally from like 3 or 4 years ago. I'm just like $9 and it sells. I mean, people are like, $9. Like it doesn't have to be perfect, you know.
It's good to know.
So we've been traveling this past week, so this is an example of we put our store on vacation mode for 2 weeks, and we haven't been selling like crazy, but we've still been selling stuff, and we send a note immediately when someone buys that says we're going to ship it, you know, in a week and a half, and everyone has been cool about it so far.
Not one person has said – I mean, one person said, oh, since you're not shipping right away, will you refund me the price for priority shipping? You know, send it standard or whatever parcel. And I was like, okay, that's fine. That's it. As long as we send the note right away and our store is on vacation mode. So I just say, as seen on our store, we're away till this date. So they're not like, it's not on there, you know.
Yeah, that's great. I'm glad to hear that's working out so well because it was really painful for us when we did some longer trips to shut our store off and just lose weeks of income.
Yeah. At the end of September, we're going to do the big experiment where we're gone for 6 weeks. So we're going to see if people will wait for 6 weeks for items.
That's a big risk, but we're going to try.
I'm curious to see what like people feel like after 6 weeks and you return and you've switched them from priority mail to parcel post.
Well, I'll probably just ship priority mail. Yeah.
Well, like you, we've got more travel ahead. We're traveling through most of September, a good part of October, and then again in November. So we'll be trying the same stuff.
Yeah. So we had an interesting thing happen this week, and I'd love to hear your feedback on it. And that is, we shipped like an aluminum bottle. It's kind of a special water bottle that's made in like Yakima, Washington. They usually sell for like $30, $40 new. And we shipped it brand new, like original paper in the bottle. No one ever used it, had the lid and all that. And the buyer wrote back and said, the lid's not in the package.
This is so absolutely, positively not true.
What?
So the lid has never been separated from it.
My question for you is, when I've had similar things where someone's like, you sent me the wrong size or this isn't the right shoe, I go into their feedback and see if they bought the exact same shoes from someone else. And that's usually the case. You're like, you wrote to the wrong buyer or the wrong seller. Like you're talking about a different pair of shoes than what I'm talking about. Like maybe they bought like three of those bottles, you know, for their kids or whatever.
Right. I know there's like at least one level of confusion in this sale because they had bought the bottle as a gift for someone else. And I don't even know if it was shipped to the buyer or just shipped as a gift to another person. So they've already, I responded immediately, just said, you mean like, I tried to verify what they meant by lid in this case. Like, you mean the black screw on cap as shown in the photo? Like, I just want to make sure they didn't have some other concept of what a lid was. But, I don't know. It's these kind of things that happen with eBay that are always so frustrating because the buyer really is always right from eBay's perspective. So, you know, all we can do is just be very responsive. But, you know, they'll win in this case.
I think it really diffuses. Like, if someone's actually lying and they just want you to refund them, I think it really diffuses things to say, ship it back to me and when I get it, I'll refund you.
That's exactly what you do, is that if they're trying to get a refund but keep the bottle – at least you can say, we'll send it back so you aren't going to get anything, even though we lose the money, you know?
And they have to go spend a few bucks to do it.
Right.
I had a similar thing happen to me. We were working at this conference, and I bought these pair of Danskos. I think I talked about it before. And I literally wore them for one day, and the soles completely fell apart. Which has actually happened to customers of me. So I'm like, I'm on the other end of this now. And so I wrote to them and I was like, these are totally defective, to the person on eBay. And I asked for my money back. And they said, okay, return them. And I'm like, why would I spend the money to return these if they're like literally supposed to go in the trash?
But you showed pictures.
I sent her photos. Yeah. Yeah, I took photos of like the chunks falling off the bottom of the shoe. But so what was good was she understood and she just gave me a refund. She didn't make me send them back.
That's the right thing, to send photos.
Yeah.
To switch topics just a tad, one of the things that happened in our store this week is I shipped out, I sold a little hair barrette that was tortoiseshell, and I must have snuck myself through the system because, you know, eBay blocks tortoiseshell merchandise. But I was able to do it. I listed it. I sold it for $50. I thought that was a kind of an achievement.
I was going to ask you about that because I saw that on your completed listings. And at first I looked at it and I was like, that's real tortoiseshell. I don't know how she got by and sold that because they will take that down so fast.
I know. Yeah, I don't know how it slipped through.
Have you guys gotten smacked down by eBay at all lately for listing stuff that's not acceptable?
Yeah, I was listing last week and they sent me a note because I called a sweater. It was like British military style sweater. That's what I called it because that's basically what it is. It just looks like it's from the military.
But it wasn't a military sweater, and they told us we had to rename it.
But the good thing is they didn't take my listing down, which is what they usually do, is they'll just take the listing down. But they allowed me to revise it, so I did revise it. That was the only thing.
So the other thing with us on the road and I think it's important for us to state this, is our notebooks. We noticed that you guys were making fun of that we do our notebooks for our listings.
Steno notebook.
Yeah.
So because we're traveling, Ryan had a lot of downtime where I was working and she had some downtime. So she was a listing out of our notebooks. And you listed what?
Oh, I listed like, I must have listed over 100 items just in my hotel room while Jay was working. So that's the reason why we do the notebooks, because we build up like a bulk. You know, like I have a folder system of stuff that we do. So I have like folders of jackets, folders of housewares, folders of whatever. Actually, it's even crazier than that. Because I didn't want to carry around my notebooks with me on the road, I scanned all of them. So I have like electronic versions that I just, you know, it's a JPEG and I bring it up on my computer and I just... But I'm able to list from anywhere. As long as I have my laptop, I just sit there and list, like, in my hotel room or wherever. So that's why the notebooks work for us.
So I'm curious, Ryan, with the notebooks, are you putting in real detailed information about the quality and the if there's, like, an imperfection? Are you putting down measurements?
Yep. Yeah, so what the notebooks are is... I'll say, you know, eBay folder 175. Well, I'm up to like 600 now. But so then I'll say item number one. Okay, it's an L.L. Bean jacket. Well, Jay will write out the title. Vintage L.L. Bean barn jacket, khaki, size large, men's. And then all the measurements and then any imperfections. But the imperfections are also in the photos. So if I'm like, oh, there's a button missing, I'll type that in. So that's all the information. Oh, and the weight, you know, 3 pounds. And that's all I need to list it. So he's off taking pictures, like I'm not paying attention, and he gets all that information, and then he just hands me the notebook with the SD card, and I'm ready to list.
Yeah, we do something really similar, and I know we've talked about this in our process before, but I'll show you since you guys can see it. Is I just have a little notepad where I write down the dimensions.
Yep.
And it's got the weight dimensions and the product name, and I just photograph it as the last shot of each item, so I don't have to keep the paper with me, because usually I just list as I'm watching movies at night, so I don't want to pick up items or measure them or weigh them or anything, but it's pretty similar. I mean, I just kind of cut out the notebook entirely because I don't want to write down all the notes.
Well, on this blog post, we could actually do a little snapshot and show people our notebook, just so they can see what we do.
Yeah, that's basically what you just showed me, that notebook. I mean, that's pretty much what we're doing. But because we split it up the way we do, where Jay takes photos and I list, you know, you guys are listing your own items that you bought at a yard sale. Like, it just split up differently. That's
yeah.
all.
I can see the pros and cons of both sides.
Yeah.
Sure. So we had a big win with Ship Cover, which is the insurance that eBay is associated with eBay.
Right. So we had talked about this earlier where I had a crazy customer, didn't want to verify the Ship Cover claim. And what Ship Cover told me was she has 30 days to verify the claim. If she doesn't verify it after 30 days, send us this information, proof that you gave her a refund and proof that she sent you a note that it was broken. So I had gotten this woman's email address at Ship Cover. And I sent them a screenshot of the PayPal refund and the note that she sent me through eBay messages. It was actually the resolution center. And they refunded me within less than 24 hours. They manually verified the claim. So I got my money.
Wow. Now that's like 100 times faster than USPS.
I've never done USPS insurance. I have no idea what that entails.
But we've heard it's slow.
I've heard it's slow. And they can deny a claim for any reason they want.
Yeah. In our earlier days, using UPS, so not the Postal Service, but the actual commercial UPS, we've had some terrible delays in getting refunds. I mean, like 60 to 90 days.
I highly recommend Ship Cover. I have only had good experiences with them every time.
Is there an additional cost for it?
Yeah, it costs. There's a whole fee schedule. It's a little bit more than USPS, but for me, it's worth it because of all the convenience. It's like $1.65 per $100 of value. It's something like that.
So you're still picking and choosing items to use it for.
Right. So my rule is anything glass, get ship cover, no matter what the price they paid for the glass.
Or item. Electronics.
Or electronics or electrical. Anything that turns on. If for some reason it gets to them, they say, it doesn't turn on. Insurance.
And also anything over, it's $50, basically.
Basically, you know, not clothes over $50. If it's going internationally, I will do clothes over $50. But that's my rule, basically.
I was going to switch topics and just mention something that we had picked up this week that was not really new to us. It's something we've been dabbling in for a while, and eBay doesn't seem to care. But I've been buying a bunch of diabetic crap.
I keep coming across
it at yard sales. Yeah. Do you guys ever sell that stuff?
Yeah, like those test strips and stuff. I've seen those.
Mm-hmm. The blood testers, they're two like separate things. But I come across them a lot when people are like emptying a household and just dumping everything in the bathroom. And it's pretty easy to get pretty big lots of it, like 1,000 test strips and stuff. And it's not big money, but you pay a quarter for those things and they immediately turn into $30 or more. So
medical supplies.
We love it, yeah. I mean, we get... Right.
Blood pressure pumps.
Yeah, blood pressure pumps are big.
Any pulse? Well, what is it like to read your pulse? Like the electronic ones too. Those are really big.
Mm-hmm. What are these called?
The stethoscope.
Stethoscope. Yeah, yes. We've moved quite a few stethoscopes. And another use for stethoscopes is for vehicles, so you can listen to your engine. So people buy them for that reason. So if you find like a scrappy old one. It's okay.
Yeah, it's good to point out that they have these other uses because stethoscope is one of those borderline items where eBay will flag you for medical supply.
Really?
So not 100%, but I put up like 3 stethoscopes in one day and one of them got flagged.
Huh.
So,
weird.
I think you have to be careful with the medical claim side.
Mm. So something else, we sold that piece of furniture that we talked about, I think, a week or two ago. And the couple actually came out to our house and looked at it and bought it and paid in cash and gave us good feedback. And it all worked.
The furniture experiment has begun.
Yeah. And we have another piece of furniture up, a sewing table that we up for $1,200.
It's actually a sewing machine. Right. The machine is in it.
And we got an email from someone that wants from it's New Jersey that wants to come down. You know, it's about 4 hours away to our house on Sunday.
Yeah, so we are like on the border of becoming like furniture sellers.
I saw you guys moving in that direction. It's very interesting, but it seems like you're managing it.
We'll see. As long
as we have places to put stuff. The thing is, it's the amazing thing is it's big money. That's the thing. Like people pay thousands of dollars for unique furniture, so. If you can store it, if you can haul it and store it, most people don't want to do it. So that's our theory.
Yeah. We're just putting our toe in right now.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Oh, so I have a question for you. We got a new car, and we're going to sell our previous car, a Beetle. And we live so remote, and we've just had difficulty using Craigslist. There's also a lot of scamming, and we just get all these scammy emails. So we're thinking about putting it on eBay.
That would be cool. I mean, that's a big part of eBay's business. Do you have any doubts about it?
I'm just curious. It would be the biggest item I ever sold on eBay, but I have to admit, I once bought a car on eBay. We bought an old Mercedes that we converted to waste vegetable oil on eBay.
Yeah. Well, they're going to take a significant commission on that that car, and that money, if it goes through PayPal, will also take a hit. So it doesn't really make sense to move it on eBay if we can move it on Craigslist. Like, we have a buyer set up right now coming from Utah on Saturday.
Maybe.
As long as that doesn't fall through. But we've had buyer after buyer fall through due to our remoteness.
Huh. Well, but the good thing about eBay is, and what you're selling is a diesel Beetle. People look all over the country. When we were looking for a diesel car, which we did not end up buying, but we would look all over the country. Like, we're willing to fly there, you know, and so that's the great thing about eBay. You might get a higher price.
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah.
Us too. We were willing to travel for our newer diesel. And luckily we only had to travel for 3 hours, but we were willing to fly.
Yep.
And that might be an example of putting it on auction and just seeing if it gets a little crazy.
What happens? You know?
That's true. Yeah. You know, it might get way higher to help cover those fees from PayPal and eBay. It might get high enough where you're like, whoa, that was good.
That's an interesting thought.
Yeah.
You know, someone in California might come out, you know.
Oh, I had a funny sale this week, to switch topics. We had some items that we had put up for sale several weeks ago, months ago even, and they were just like industrial staples for like staping down your floorboard. Like if you have a wood floor you're putting in, a tongue and groove, these would staple the tongue down. And they didn't move at all for months. And I had like a lot of them, like separate. I had maybe 6 different packs or 9 packs, and I had them all separate. And all of a sudden, they just started moving this week. So it's always so strange to have these things where nothing moves, and then all of a sudden, the same week, to different locations, items start moving. I'm surprised how often that happens with eBay.
I often wonder if it's because someone on a blog or on a forum, people were talking about them, and someone did a search and just, you know, paste it in a search on an eBay search. And
I think that that's got to be it, because we find that happens very frequently where I'll sell like 2 very particular kinds of fabric or something to 2 people in totally different places, like someone in England and someone in Utah. And you're like, what? Hmm. And I'm like, some specialty blog must have linked to these or something.
Yeah, I think that's exactly it, because I had some Apple AirPorts, like the little Apple Wi-Fis that plug right in to a wall, and they're expensive. They sell for like $60 to $80 used, and they're really not that great. There's way better Wi-Fi devices today. But all of a sudden, something happened, and there was like a run on them. I sold both within an hour, like internationally. So I figured someone figured out how to hack it or reverse the firmware or something, because people just wanted these. Then, and they must have been in my store for 9 months. You know?
We've seen that happen.
So the last thing we have to talk about is, so we're in Manhattan right now, and we're here for the week. And we went to an auction last night in Brooklyn. There aren't a lot of auctions at all. They're all over in New Jersey. But we found this one. It was in a really kind of ghetto part of Brooklyn. And it was just like one of those bodega storefronts. And there were like 10 people there, and yeah, it was run by like this a Russian couple and their daughters. And it was so ghetto and so much fun.
It was so funny. Like, we thought, oh, New York has these like high-end, you know, auctions where you have to be a member and you have to pay like a cover fee. But these people were just like, no. Just come into our like little warehouse. And
it was basically a thrift store that they ran like an auction house. They just had a bunch of junk. And
we found great stuff.
And they were just like, the guy wasn't an auctioneer. He was just like this a Russian guy. He was like, $5, okay, $5, $6.
And it was so funny because they were selling things for so low that I'm like, why don't they just have a thrift store and sell everything for $5? I don't get that. But anyway, it was hilarious. And it's always fun to go to a new place and look up an auction. And just, we had a great time. Like all the customers were like laughing because the auctioneers were so hilarious.
So ridiculous.
So anyway, that was our night.
That sounds like a great auction.
Was there anything Russian about the stuff at the auction?
Nope. It was all just, looks just, it was a lot of junk, but we got like a lot of cool art and this like antique Chinese bell. It was just, it was a perfect scavenger place, but there was so much shit, but there was a lot of really cool stuff hidden in there. And the people buying, they didn't really know what was good or what was bad.
They didn't care, but it was really fun. So it's always fun to go to a new town and just look up an auction and be like, what will people be like? You know, will they be funny? Will they be serious? Will they be like rich people, you know?
Now, were the lots smaller that they were selling and auctioning as compared to like being out in a remote area where everyone just shows up with their pickup truck and trailer and is ready to haul stuff off?
Right.
Yeah, this was totally different, where it was like a storefront and it was kind of like a thrift shop, everything on shelves, and you would go in there and you would pull off on the shelf what you wanted and put it on a big table up front, and that's what they would auction off. The people buying are the ones that would pick the stuff that would get auctioned.
Which I've never seen before.
Okay, well, we have like another episode coming up, episode 44, which is us, all 4 of us, looking back at 5 months of running this podcast. Do you guys have anything else you want to close with for this one?
Nah, that's it. Let's do it.
All right.